So today, so we have been actually discussing a lot of development, quality, pre-production. So what I'd be talking mostly is once Agile ends and when production starts. So I have been a production operations engineer, architect, consultant for last 16 years. So once the code moves to production, what happens? So I would present that picture and I would be a continuation to Shovik. Shovik like showed the whole thing up till pre-prod. So now mine is pure prod. What happens in pure prod? So feel free to stop me in between if you have any questions. So that's about me already. So what I do, I have been working with global clients, Fortune 500 clients across geographies and across industry verticals, finance, banking, retail, services, energy. So whatever industry verticals you can think of, I have covered all. So that is what is my experience all about. So currently emerging technologies, I have a very keen interest on security, DevOps, AI, IoT, blockchain analytics. So you will feel that what a production operation guy is doing in all these emerging technologies. Because end of the day, once you developers and QAs, once the developer develops that cutting edge, bleeding edge technology, and once the QA tests it properly, finally it's going to get hosted on production. So that is where I need to be aware, like what is coming, what will finally get hosted on the production, which I have to take care, which I have to architect for. So that is where I have keen interest. So my hobbies are, I'm an active cyclist, I read a lot of books, both technical, non-technical, and also I do a lot of traveling. So that photo that you see, I was a solo traveler in Orissa. There's a place called Katak, there's a place Puri. So I just had a Activa and I was traveling solo. No friends, no mobile, no internet, nothing. So just cash in hand, bike, and my backpack, that's it, nothing else. So that's the photo from there. So typically when you're in a group, you have group dynamics, somebody wants to do something. When you're solo, you do whatever you want. But again, you don't have a backup as well. Anything happens to you, you're on your own. Next. So that's my LinkedIn link, if anybody wants to connect. So this is a very interesting video, whether it will play or not, I'm not sure. Oh, okay, it doesn't play. So actually, I'll just tell you briefly about the video. So this video actually compares how Formula One race used to be when Formula One started. Like a pit stop for a Formula One car back when it started in 1960s, 70s used to take a lot of time. And currently the Formula One pit stop takes like few seconds. So that's what the video was all about. So again, it's not playing. So that is what is agility. So how the world is becoming agile from all perspectives, not only software and hardware, even the normal lives have become agile. That is what the video depicts. So that is what pace of change is becoming in our economy is accelerating very fast. That is what everybody has to pace up. So when the developer is developing fast and when the QA is also testing fast, then the production team also has to be ready to deploy it into production fast. So that is the main thing where we are also getting into the agile mode. Or else all the code, all the latest cutting edge code you develop sits in pre-prod. It doesn't hit production. It is not ready for production. Okay. So same thing. So as you would have noticed, in the last like maybe 10-20 years, there has been a lot of changes. So at some point in time in IT, so currently all the people who are here, so how many of you are on cloud? Okay, so rest are not on cloud. So how many of you here have a Gmail account? Anybody who doesn't use Gmail? Okay, fine. So so let me just tell you, everybody knowingly or unknowingly is on cloud. Okay, So the Gmail that you use, the Facebook that you use, anything, everything in our life, it's cloud in some way or the other. How many, one more poll I want to do. How many people here feel is mainframes are dead? Or mainframes will be dead in the next 5 to 10 years? Like containers will take over. Anybody who feels mainframe will be dead in the next 5 to 10 years? Okay. Rest all feel mainframe is going to be there? Okay. Reality check. Currently, any banking transaction you do, any credit card you process, 95% of those transactions are processed by a mainframe somewhere in the world. So mainframes are still there, they will remain. Okay, so it's not going to die anytime soon. So IBM still exists, and still also all the people who work on mainframes, it's not going to die so soon. It's just a reality check. Okay, software is eating the world. Everybody knows this guy. So we are in 2018, so mostly what we do is whenever we present, we give data of 2025 and 2020, 2030, if I am not doing that, I am putting 2018, we are in 2018. So we can actually check whether this is correct or not. Okay. So here it says that 1/3 of the top 20 market share leaders will be disrupted by the third platform. So what is the third platform? So this is the third platform. So all of this is impacting anyways, isn't it? All of the companies. So Uber, everybody knows how it has disrupted the taxi industry, and all taxis now are forced to join Uber. There is no choice, or else there is no business. So does Uber own any taxi? So means just a hypothetical situation. Let's say Uber decides to close down in India. What will be the exit time frame of Uber? Any idea? Any guesses? Any guesses? Means how will it take 1 year, 2 years, 5 years, 6 months? Any guesses? If Uber decides to close down India, okay, I'll give you an answer. It's just a 1 day. All the legal procedures done, they will switch off their servers, which are on the cloud. The app stops working, game over. They don't own any taxis. All their offices are rented, their office space are rented, so that's it. So the exit is so easy because of the third platform. So they own nothing, only the app is theirs. Okay, this is your CEO, so I need not say more. So he's talking more about DevOps. So I don't want to spend much time on DevOps because we have been listening to DevOps since yesterday. Everybody knows what is DevOps. So I'll focus more on Ops. Okay. So typically my presentation was mostly for the ops crowd. So I speak in conferences where there are more like storage experts, network experts, and cloud experts. So they want to know more about the dev. So here I will talk more about ops. So Gartner, everybody is aware, Gartner is an industry leader, third party analysis company. So they have come up with a very nice model, which is called a bimodal IT. So currently, only if you are a new age startup, then you are completely on cutting leading edge technology. Rest, if you are a large enterprise with lot of legacy and lot of technical debt, so you would be running bimodal. So your old applications which are still running good, you will not refactor them. You will not take your application which is running nice without a single day or a single minute downtime. You will not convert it into a container because there is no business sense out of that. Because it is working fine, so let it work. Whatever new I have to develop today for the social platform, for the artificial intelligence platform, that will be on the new platform. So that is what is bimodal. This is the model that all enterprises are following. So this is very, very critical. So you can read whatever is written. Yeah, so reliability and compliance is what ITIL says. So ITIL is a predominantly an operation framework, which the operations world follows. Development and test environment don't follow ITIL. So DevOps is what the development and QA follow. So this is the stark difference between both. So reliability, compliance, and rapid development. So here, adding on to the DevOps, there's a very critical component, security. So since today morning, I think so, if some of you have attended the hacking or the hacker event where a Bluetooth device can be hacked, an IoT device can be hacked. So security is a very critical component. So I am very active in many security forums. So what I predominantly feel is that the developer and the QA community are not that much exposed to security aspects of any code. So what I would urge all my developer and QA friends out here to also have security in mind. Because if your code has vulnerabilities, those will be exploited very easily. So, because definitely once it hit productions, there are security experts who will check the security aspects of things. But however, code vulnerabilities are tough to detect. So that is what I feel that a security aspect should be there to DevOps. So I know everybody knows this, I will not discuss this further, what is DevOps. So DevOps, everybody has their own perspective, depends on what background you are coming from. Okay, so that is an elephant for all the people. So this is the actual scenario. So when we say DevOps, Dev and Ops are never friends. So anybody here who, how many people here from Dev? Dev QA? How many people Ops? Only one, a few. So do Dev and Ops like each other? Do they love each other? Do they go on outing and not the company paid outing, personal outing? Do they go together? Do they go like on Friday night drink parties and all? They hate each other to the core. Okay. It's only the company which keeps them together, isn't it? So that is what is DevOps. So I have been Ops, so I always fight with the devs. Your code cannot be deployed. This is the problem. This is the challenge. This is the security loophole. This particular port is open. This is something or the other. Something latest not approved. This version not approved. Okay. So all that is the constant fight going on. So this is the actual scenario, real life. Okay. So difference is that developers want freedom. They want to try everything new. Whatever comes on open source, whatever comes on GitHub, they want to incorporate everything into their code. And operations, they want to everything. They want standardized, secure, and a managed environment. They don't want any troubles, no downtimes. So that is the reason operation guys always run n minus 1, n minus 2. Whatever is the latest release, we will be always n minus 1. We will wait for the patches to come, for the update fixes to come. Then only we will deploy. So same things, I'll move on. Conversations. So basically we have to enable communication between both. Both have to talk to each other. That is very, very critical in DevOps. And build trust. Means the developer should trust the operations. That and operations should also trust the developer. That both are working for the same application. They are not like two different teams. So this is what is the photo shows. And we have to develop a culture of playing together. So when we are in a sprint, we are working for the deadline for the sprint. So again, we have to strike a balance. And finally, this is like ideal state when you are sharing and you know each other's pain and you are helping each other resolve the problems. And then comes honeymoon. Okay. So this is the, what you call, as Sovic rightly told, that is a dream state. Okay. So this is, I don't know which companies actually have it. In reality, so on paper everybody is doing it, but on reality I don't know. Okay, now moving on to ops side. So majority of the budget in operations is spent on operations, which is keeping the lights on, maintenance, keeping the lights on. That is 80% of the budget is filled in. Okay, so there's no budget left for any innovation or trying out new things in operations. So how IT evolved? So here, anybody has worked in waterfall? Cool, few people, good. So then some people know what is the difference. So when there was waterfall, all applications were three-tier, N-tier, monolithic, physical servers, and all companies had their own data centers. And all dev and QA had their own server farms. Nobody can touch their servers. The servers keep running for years together. There is 0.1% activity on that server when the test is done. The rest of the time it is just powered on. Okay, that is where I'm coming from. So I have handled those servers as well. Okay, so that is the reason I have put it. Then came Agile. Agile made it multi-tier virtual servers, and from your own data center you went to a co-located data center. Like somebody else is a data center hoster. So you host on there and you pay rent. Like how you pay your rent for your house, you pay rent for a data center, that is called hosted data center. Then came DevOps and microservices and containers and cloud. So currently we are here However, there are many companies, many applications which are still in the top one, in the middle one, and they are transitioning. So once those applications die, then the new applications will follow the latest trend. So that is one. Okay, so same thing, pretty much. Yeah, pretty much same thing. I'll move on. So these are few like sample architectures from operations once they are deployed. So first one is just a OS with an app. Second one has virtual machines, and third one has got containers. So three types I have shown. So typically, what happens is previously everything was a silo. Like I have an application, I have my server, my storage, my network. Okay, so I have budget for my application, so I'll buy stuff for mine. So that was used to be the case. So even if I am using it 20%, rest 80% I will not share with any other application, because this is my budget, this is my server. That used to be the case, silos. So then came the demand with agile, DevOps, elasticity, flexibility, rapid deployment, and to reduce complexity. This was the demand. So as I told you, server storage, networking, power and cooling, traditional IT. Then came virtualization and converged infrastructure. So I will be discussing converged infrastructure going forward. And then came flash storage. So everybody here understands what is a flash? Who doesn't understand a flash? Okay. Anybody knows the solid state device, SSD? Yeah. So flash is the operations term for SSD. It is capable of high throughputs. And then you also have hyper-converged infrastructure now, when what happens is the compute, storage and the network can be on a single rack. In a data center, you have racks. So on a single rack, you get everything. Compute, storage, network. That is a hyper-converged. And then also there is orchestration and automation. So orchestration and automation will actually reduce manual effort, will reduce system administrators, database administrators, network administrators who are manually configuring new systems, updating patches. So all those aspects can be automated using orchestration and automation. And then anyways, agile infrastructure is the end state where you are truly agile. So this is typically the architecture that you see. That is like a very complicated architecture. Everything now can be done on a single plan. That is what I wanted to showcase here. And then there is a very interesting concept, network function virtualization and software defined networking. I know there was a session before me, if anybody has attended that. So physical network devices are getting converted into virtual machines. The virtual machines will actually do the network router, network switch, load balancer, firewall, all these activities will be virtualized. So that is what is software defined networking and network function virtualization. That will bring in lot of cost optimization, because hardware devices from proprietary vendors are very, very expensive. So this will bring in a very cost effectiveness. So again, I'll skip through because I don't have much time. I won't be able to explain the whole architectures. So benefits I already covered, that lower capex and opex, capital expense and operating expense in operations world. So virtual machines, how they were, and containers, this everybody knows, so I'll not spend any more time on this. Everybody knows what's the difference. So main benefit of containers in a operations world is that wherever they find a Docker environment, they can run. That's the, and they can run on pretty much everything. Any of these environment which can run a Docker layer can host a container. That's the benefit from a operations point of view for a container. Yeah, so Linux, Windows, mainframe, Amazon, Azure, any public cloud. So whichever offers a container service, they can run there. That's the beauty. So your app can go anywhere. They are not tied down to a particular, like it has to be on a Linux box, it has to be on a Windows box. So all those dependencies are lost. So you can move between infrastructures. Okay, that is the beauty that I see with container. But however, for containers, applications have to be containerized, in the sense it has to be microservices based, and your traditional SAP, Oracle, they cannot get into containers. All that still problems still exist. So scale up, everybody knows, you increase the memory, CPU, storage, or you increase the number of nodes, put it on a load balancer, and scale up, scale down, or scale out, scale in. Then comes automation. As I told, so automation, what happens is every team is doing their own automation. Database team has got their own scripts, and server team has got their own scripts. Everybody is running their own automation. So those are called like islands of automation. Then we have closed loop automations, where multiple team automations are tied together using orchestrator. So they are like office flow. So that is the ideal state, orchestrate, where everything is interlinked and everything goes in a flow and gives you the desired result without any manual intervention, full automation. So again, I will skip through. This is showcasing the various areas which can be automated together using orchestrator. So what are different tools from disparate vendors? So no enterprise has a single vendor policy that I will only have IBM or Red Hat or HP or whatever. They have products from all over. So orchestrators which can actually automate things across the board are required for effective automation. That is what is being highlighted here. So this is a use case. Again, I have very less time, I won't run through it. This is an end-to-end automation for a process, where a person used to take maybe a few hours to do it, now it will be executed in a matter of seconds. So with this, is the infrastructure problem solved? No, because if you are building your own infrastructure, own server, own network, own storage, it's very complicated, as you can see. So this is just a diagram. If you see a data center architecture diagram, you will fall off. It is so complicated. So you need some guy who understands every tidbit, and on that also there are chances of errors. If there is any error, the entire performance, latency, everything goes in for a toss. Okay, it's very complex. So then comes cloud. So now everybody knows that cloud is like solution to all problem. All problem in this world, any issues you face, just put it on cloud, and cloud gonna take care. So just a reality check again. Just like the mainframe. So yeah, so there is no single cloud which can meet like all the requirements. Clouds, there are different types of cloud, different varieties of cloud based on the different workloads, based on the different use cases, industry verticals. So that expertise is where a cloud consultant, architect, practitioner brings in on the table. He knows it, he can help you guide it. So this everybody knows, I'll not cover IaaS, as PaaS and SaaS. So here comes different types of open source and some vendor cloud platforms. So I'll just skip through, it's too detailed. So which cloud to go to? Is it Amazon? Is it Azure? Is it Google Cloud? So that is the question. So why you want to go to cloud? And what is the workload that you want to move to cloud? All that questions have to be asked before we can decide which cloud suits. Okay, there's no single answer. So developers might prefer Amazon cloud or whatever. If it's a .NET developer, he'll go to Azure cloud. If he loves Google, he'll go to Google cloud. But operations doesn't work that way. Operations have different parameters to use a cloud platform for deploying production apps. So these are various types of cloud computing patterns for production. So how the burst comes, what is the load, accordingly we take a call, we decide. So which workload goes where? This is a very, very critical component in cloud architecture and cloud consulting. So SAP can go where, Oracle can go where, because enterprise apps are typically not, they have lot of vendor component involved, because there is a lot of stringent SLAs signed, there is lot of penalty clauses, those are signed between vendors and clients. So hence these applications means has to be decided which particular cloud platform is used. So traditional IT, cloud native, already I have covered the bimodal, this is into more details. So benefits of cloud everybody knows, so I will not cover. So there is no capex, no upfront buying of anything, you pay as you go, like your mobile bill, like your electricity bill, okay. But you have to be careful because the bill can be very high as well. Scale up, down, you can scrap any type. So once you hosted your application on a cloud platform, how much time will it take to move to a different cloud platform? Let's say they offered you 50% discount. Is it as simple as your mobile MNP? Like you move from Airtel to Vodafone, you send a SMS. Just okay. So depends on your application landscape, depends on the count of servers, virtual machines, containers, complexity. It can take years for large enterprises to move from one cloud platform to another. Okay, it's a huge, huge effort. So serverless, everybody is aware of serverless? Okay, many people don't know. So serverless, I just added few points here because currently it's a trend now that all ops guys will be fired and ops won't exist any further. There will be only developer and serverless. Okay, that's the new thing coming in. So I don't have much time to go details into it. So serverless is more like a function call. So if your application can do only function calls and rely on function calls only, then you don't need to manage any server, anything, neither in Amazon nor in Azure nor in private cloud nor anywhere. Okay, you just consume the function calls, pay for the function calls, that's it. So you're virtually, means the ops is eliminated, so no more fights. Okay, no more fights between dev and ops. So these are few of the benefits. Again, I have last few minutes, but the challenge is vendor lock-in. Do you feel that once you move on to a particular cloud platform, you are vendor locked? Or do you feel that you are free to move out immediately? Yeah. So function as a service, our serverless is tied to that particular like vendor. You cannot immediately port your code. Your code doesn't work with another vendor. So all these security is a major challenge. Enterprises won't go. Yeah, moving on. So again, from an operations point of view, high availability is very, very critical. Okay, we sign legal contracts on high availability, scalability, and monitoring. Okay, so this is infra as a code, it's already covered. Fine, so I think so. This is all DevOps stuff, it's covered. These are few of the sample like architectures for few industry verticals, just like a 10,000 feet over. That's this one was insurance industry on Oracle. This is healthcare, VDI, and this is for online content provider. So that's it. So any questions, then please feel free to ask. Anything on operations or is that enough? Okay, thank you.
So that gets us to the end of Agile track, and lightning talks will be happening in campus view displays in 5 to 10 minutes. Please don't forget to tweet. Please do put in your feedback in the DevConf site. Thank you. Thank you, guys.